you are propagating Hindu religious ideas. What effect is it going to have on a conservative Muslim market? You see, a large section of India is Muslim. In fact, before 1947, the percentage of Muslims was even more because some of it has gone to Pakistan. Today, I think about 17-18% population of India are Muslim. Before 1947, perhaps 25% population of India are Muslim. Now, if you keep on injecting religion into politics, if you keep on propagating Hindu religious ideas, as Gandhi did, year after year, talking of Gauraksha, Ram Raj, Varnasam, you have Raghupati Raghav Raja Ram singing in political meetings, mind you. It's not a bhasham of a sadhu. What effect is it going to have on the conservative Muslim mind? Will it not drive the Muslims toward a fundamentalist organization like the Muslim League? And therefore, are you not serving the British policy of divide and rule? And therefore, are you not objectively a British agent? You see, when I call Gandhi a British agent, I am not saying that he was being paid salary by the British. But he was serving the interests by dividing Hindus and Muslims. So objectively, are you not acting as a British agent? Then secondly, Gandhi acted in British agent in this way, that in early 20th century, a revolutionary movement had started. You see, you must get one thing very clear. A real freedom struggle everywhere has to be a violent struggle, a revolution. Because the people who have conquered your country, imperialists, you think they will give up their country without a fight? Did the Americans fight against the British from 1775 to 1781? Did the Americans fight against the British with flowers and lollipops? Or with guns, with the Continental Army under George Washington? Did Bolivar fight the Spaniards in Latin America with Satyagraha or with battalions? Did Ho Chi Minh fight the French with guns or with salt marches? Nobody gives up his conquered territory without a freedom struggle, which has to be an armed struggle. All this talk that Gandhi gave us freedom and all nonsense. See, India became independent not because of Gandhi, but because the Second World War broke out, in which Germany attacked England and weakened it, and may perhaps have conquered England but for American help to the British. And because the Americans put pressure on the British, for these reasons, the British left India. It was the Second World War, it's nothing to do with Gandhi. The real revolutionary movement which has started in the early 20th century, men like Bhagat Singh, Chandrasekhar Azad, Surya Sen, also known as Master Da in Bengal, Khudiram Bose, Ram Prasad Bismil, they had started a revolutionary armed struggle in India for freedom struggle against the British. It would have developed into a mature freedom struggle. But what the British became very scared of this rising revolutionary movement in India in the early 20th century. And so they brought Gandhi, who diverted the freedom struggle from this revolutionary direction, which was the real freedom struggle, towards a harmless channel called Satyagraha, nonsensical channel that you go on hunger strike. Do you think the British would leave India because Gandhi goes on hunger strike? Does anybody give up his empire like this? That you make a salt march, you go on hunger strike, all this drama, and you sing Garagupati Raghava Rajanam and the British will leave India. He was a fake Mahatma, and in fact he did great damage to India by serving the British interest in these two ways. One, by injecting religion into politics, and the second, by diverting the real genuine freedom struggle from a revolutionary direction to a harmless, nonsensical channel called Satyagraha. So he served the British. And Jinnah was his counterpart. So both were British agents. And all this led to ultimately the partition of India in 1947 and creation of a fake artificial country called Pakistan. You see, I don't regard Pakistan as any country. I don't even call it a country. It's a fake entity because it was made on the basis of the two-nation theory. that Hindus and Muslims are two separate nations. See, this is on the face of it nonsense. How can religion be the basis of a nation? If religion is the basis of a nation, no country can survive. England has Roman Catholics, several kind of Protestants, it has Hindus, Muslims, Jews. So England should also be broken up into many pieces, partitioned into many parts. So should the United States be. See, this is nonsense. No country can survive if you go on the basis of religion as a nation, as the basis of nationality. This was all the British trick to keep Hindus and Muslims fighting with each other and thereby remain weak. You see, you are fighting with each other like fools, which you are, 90% of you are. I openly say you are idiots, you can't understand. $40 billion worth of arms are purchased every year by the Indian government from foreign countries. Now, much of it, this money could be saved and spent on the welfare of your people instead of buying. India is the biggest arms purchaser in the world. You are buying $40 billion worth of arms every year. Why? Because you have to put much of the army on the Pakistani front. So it's a waste of money which could have gone for the welfare of the people. So I have written an article called The Truth About Pakistan. That also is on my blog, where I have explained in Pakistan how it was created. It's a fake country and one day it will be reunited in India, but it's going to take maybe 20 years or so because the poison has been so deeply into us. You see, when I meet Pakistanis, I met many of them, and I'm sure they will be on your Stanford campus. I feel no different from them. I look like them. I speak the same language, Hindustani. I have the same cultural habits, eating habits. We are actually one people. This is a fake partition. Some people say, but this happened in 1947, which is 68 years ago, so time has passed. So my reply is the time passed in Germany also, which was partitioned in 1945, but it was reunited in 1990. Some people say you are dreaming of reunification of India and Pakistan. I said, Mazzini was also said to be dreaming when he thought of uniting Italy. People said he's just a dreamer. At that time, Italy was divided into many states. But later his dream came to be true by Cavour and Garibaldi, who united Italy. So we are actually one country and we are bound to be united. The truth is, see, I'm sorry to say this, but see, many people have criticized me for saying that 90% Indians are fools and idiots. But it is the truth. And I'm saying this not to demoralize you, not to denigrate you. Rather, I'm saying this because I love you. I want you to cease to be idiots and become intelligent people, rational people, scientific people, logical people. I don't want to harm you, I want to help you. Because I must tell you the truth. How backward you are. You are full of casteism. Will you give your daughters in marriage to a Dalit? Come on, answer this question. How many of you will? All right. You people, you are young people, you will do it. But you ask your parents. They will say, we'll rather die than do it. You are enlightened young people, and I'm very happy that many of you raise your hands. But you ask your parents. Most of them are die-hard casteists. They will. You know, I got an email from a young a Dalit girl who is studying in M.Tech in Delhi. And she said, I am having an affair with an upper caste boy for last 6-7 years. But he said, my parents are dead against our marriage because you are impenetrable. I won't touch, they say they will not touch the grass which you touch. What should I do? Because I told them, tell the young man, I said, now 6 years have passed. Either you accept me or accept your parents, you can't keep you hanging forever. But look at the mentality. People, there are caste killings in so many terms. Honor killings. If a girl of a non-Dalit caste falls in love or tries to marry a boy of a Dalit caste. Both are murdered brutally. There are these caste panchayats called Kap panchayats, etc. in India, who order killings, brutal murder. And, you know, I gave a judgment that whoever does honor killing, it should be given death sentence. But I know my judgment will never be implemented. And you know why? Because the politicians are dependent on these caste panchayats for their vote banks. So they will not like to displease the caste panchayats. And therefore the chief ministers will give instructions to the police officers, the superintendent of police and district magistrate, etc., that don't interfere with any honor killing because they don't want to lose their vote banks. So the police people also turn a Nelson's eye to such murders. This is the reality of India. There is horrible casteism in India. I was the Chief Justice of Madras High Court. There was a judge of the High Court who belonged to the Dalit caste, Shedul caste. His wife was of an upper caste. They had a love marriage about 25 years back. One day they came to meet me and my wife. And the wife of the judge, who had belonged to an upper caste, she said that when we got married, we had a love marriage, my relatives performed my funeral rites. Therefore, them I'm dead. And since then, they have refused to have anything to do with me. This is the reality of our country. Now, does it not show how big idiots you are? You regard a section of your own people as inferior. In this age of equality, when in 1776, in the Declaration of American Independence, it was said that we hold these truths to be self-evident, that all men are created equal. But 250 years have passed since then and you still regard a section of the people as inferior, which shows how backward and stupid most of you are. In elections, votes are cast normally on the basis of caste and religion. Your politics is run on the basis of caste and religion. Everybody knows this. I don't go to caste vote. I have not cast it except on one occasion. I have never gone and cast my vote. Because my vote is meaningless. People vote on the basis of caste and religion like sheep and cattle. The Yadav candidate or the Yadav will vote for him. Whether they don't care whether he's an educated man, uneducated, a good man, criminal. Nothing is relevant, only his caste is relevant. So 100,000 Yadav will vote for the Yadav candidate, 100,000 Harijan will vote for the Harijan candidate, 100,000 Muslims will vote for the Muslim candidate. Like sheep and cattle to vote, you don't see the merit of the candidate, whether he is a good man or bad. Was democracy meant to be run in this manner? So I said that I will not vote. Why should I waste my time? My vote means nothing. When people are voting as vote banks, it's like herds and droves. What is the use of wasting time and voting? Recently, I gave I'm telling you how backward India is. I gave a statement that there's nothing wrong in eating beef. Now, there was a big human cry in India. You may go on the YouTube and all kind of filthy things were said against me. Now, see, I said 90% of the world eats beef. Americans eat beef. Europeans eat beef, Arabs eat it, Africans eat it, Australians eat it. Are they all wicked people? And you Hindus alone are the saintly people. And just imagine calling a cow as your mother shows how stupid you are. How can an animal be a mother of a human being? Does it carry any sense? Have you people no brains? That is why I say that most Indians don't have brains in this area. They have gobar and bhusa hai, 90% of. You talk nonsense that a cow is a mother. I have seen cows which were driven out, you know, because they stopped yielding milk. They are driven out of the womb. And they starve to death. Many of them you will see on the roads in India eating filth and garbage. And they starve to death. Is that not cow slaughter? Making the cows starve to death? But these people are not concerned about that. They don't mind if a cow starves to death. They don't want it to be slaughtered. there is a tremendous amount of female feticide in large parts of India. There, you know, in India, a law had to be made in 1994 called the Prenatal and the Conception Diagnostic Techniques Act, 1994. That in India, it's a criminal offense if you try to find out the sex of the child in a mother's womb by ultrasound. In America, it is legal. In India, it's a criminal offense because what was happening was a large number of female children in the womb of a woman were being aborted because people don't want to have a female child. It is regarded a tragedy. If you go to a hospital, if a male child is born, everybody, the whole family celebrates and distributes sweets and are very happy. But if a female child is born, they are, the whole face is crestfallen and dejected and give a great tragedy. This is the discrimination against women in India. Discrimination against minorities. Muslims don't get housing on rent. They find it difficult to get jobs. Churches of Christians have been vandalized of late in Delhi, etc. Okay. Now there's massive poverty in India. Unemployment is massive. As I said, 10 million people come in the job market and only 500,000 jobs available in the organized sector of the economy. 50% of our children suffer from malnourishment. Healthcare is almost non-existent. All this is on my blog. Healthcare in India, malnutrition in India, unemployment in India. I put them all on the blog. Now, this is regarding what is India at present. This is the truth. We are still very poor, very backward. And let me tell you frankly, nobody respects the poor. If you want to get respect in the world, you have to make India a very prosperous and affluent country. Today, India is a poor country. We have to acknowledge the truth. Now, what had happened was that before the Industrial Revolution, which started in England around the middle of the 18th century, there were agricultural societies everywhere, feudal societies. Now, the feudal method of production by the bullock cart, bullock in India, was in Europe, there were agricultural societies. The methods of production were so primitive and backward that so little wealth could be generated that only a handful of people could be rich. These kings and aristocrats, dukes and so on, the milas in India. Remaining had to be poor because when the cake is so small, very few people can eat it. Now after the Industrial Revolution, the situation in world history has totally changed. Now modern industry is so powerful and so big that enough wealth can be generated to give a decent life to everyone. So now nobody need be poor. But the fact is 75-80% people of the world, including in India, are poor. And naturally they are demanding that now when we don't have to be poor, why are we being kept poor? So the struggle naturally better life. I can tell you a great speech was given by President Franklin Roosevelt of America in January 1944 called the Second Bill of Rights. You can see it on YouTube and on online, the Second Bill of Rights, where he said that the first Bill of Rights in the US Constitution, that is providing for liberty, freedom of speech, freedom of religion, equality, etc., is not adequate because a hungry man, an unemployed man, poor man has no use for these rights. What does a hungry man got to do with freedom? He needs food. An unemployed man needs a job. So he said that now we have to have a second Bill of Rights in the US Constitution providing that every American must be given a decent job with a decent salary and housing, health care, all free, proper education. So that, I think, applies to the whole world, not just to America. India must rapidly industrialize and become a modern industrial state. If we wish to generate the wealth we need for the welfare of our people. The problem is we are passing through a transitional period in our history. Transition from what to what? transition from a feudal agricultural society to a modern industrial society. At present, we are neither totally feudal nor totally modern. We are somewhere in between. Now, this transitional period in history is always a very painful and turbulent period. If you have read the history of Europe from, say, 16th to 19th centuries, when Europe was passing through the transitional period, it was full of turbulence, wars, revolutions, chaos, social churning, reformation, counter-reformation, English Civil War, French Revolution, theories of Voltaire, Rousseau, Hobbes, Locke, Montesquieu, Adam Smith, and so on. It was only after going through this fire that modern society emerged in Europe. India is presently going through this fire. We are going through a very painful period in our history, which I guess will last another 20 years or so. Next 20 years are going to be terrible, very turbulent, almost civil war and that condition are going to occur. Because that is how history operates. You see, what is a transition? A transition means the old society being torn apart, the feudal society being broken, completely uprooted. But the new society is not yet being put in its place. The industrial society has not yet been put in its place. If you read Shakespeare's play Macbeth, there is a line right in the beginning, fair is foul and foul is fair. Which means what was regarded fair earlier is regarded foul today and vice versa. All old value was the caste system was regarded to be good. Arranged marriages were regarded to be the way to marry and so on. All these are being questioned. But a new code of ethics has not been put into place. So at present the situation is in India, there is no code of ethics. The code of ethics of feudal society has been shattered because feudal society has been shattered. But industrial society has not been created. Industrial society also, like in America, has a code of ethics. In India, there is no code of ethics. So which means free for all. Make money hook by hook or crook. This is the order of the day in India. The young children, what will they be taught? You know, if good values are instilled in you by your parents in childhood. But if your parents themselves are crooks, what values will they instill in you? And large section of the adults in India have become crooks. Society in India has become commercialized. People are just after money but hook or crook. So there is a total vacuum prevailing in India today. The Indian constitution was created in 1950, borrowing the Western principles of freedom of speech, liberty, equality, and freedom of religion, and the modern institutions like parliament, independent judiciary, and so on. The constitution was modern, but our society was feudal and backward. And perhaps the intention of our founding father was that this constitution will pull up Indian society from its backwardness and bring it into the modern age. And to some extent it did. You see, soon after independence, Pandit Nehru was a modern minded man. He set up a heavy industrial base with his colleagues. He set up the engineering colleges of which you people are products. So India did make some progress to some extent. However, later on, what happened was that the feudals hijacked our state institutions, our democracy and everything they have taken away. So all our institutions, whether parliament, judiciary, bureaucracy, have become empty shells. They have become rotten to the core. Our politicians are a set of rogues and rascals who have no genuine love for the country. They only think of how to make money for themselves, loot the country. Parliament has a large number of criminals. There will be scam after scam, 2G scam, cold block, CWD scam, and so on. Judiciary also has become, to a very large extent, corrupt. The media is totally sold out. They have been called prostitutes by some people. Corruption is at every level. Now, the situation is, what is going to now happen? See, India in 2015 is very different from India in 1947. In 1947, because of the British policy of keeping us backward and unindustrialized, we had very few industries, very few engineers and so on. Today the situation is very different. We have thousands of outstanding engineers, technicians, scientists, some of whom here are in that category. And therefore, potentially, India is a superpower like America or China. But the fact is that our politicians are still broadly in feudal mentality. Their present leaders, they talk of Ram Mandir, Ghar Vapasi, beef ban, all these religious ideas, which are basically feudal ideas, casteism, and so on. So, because of that, we are stagnant. Our Indian economy is largely, it has become stagnant. The talk of GDP growth and all, actually there is no GDP growth, it's all a lot of big talk, but assuming there is GDP growth. The further question to be asked is, who is getting the fruits of that GDP growth? Is it just a handful of businessmen or is it the Indian masses? I don't think the Indian masses are benefiting from all that. At present we still have powerful remnants of feudalism and feudal thinking in society. And therefore a mighty cultural struggle is required, which will have to be waged by patriotic people to combat the feudal ideas, feudal thinking in India and replace them with scientific and rational thinking. And for this, great sacrifices will have to be made, without which it can't be done. One wish is that the transition period is over quickly, without pain. But this is not how history functions. The feudal elements are still very powerful in Indian society. The casteist elements, communal elements, superstitions, backwardness. 95% people in India believe in astrology, which is pure humbug and superstitions. See, how can the movement of stars and planets determine your life? On the face of it, there is no connection between it. But 95% Indians believe in it. There's tremendous backwardness in India, and the politicians in India take advantage of that. So, a great struggle is required in India. The next 20 years is going to be terrible, because as I said, this is how history functions. Transition cannot be done painlessly, without terrible conditions are going to prevail for the next 20 years. I will end my talk here and then I will invite questions from you by a couplet from one of my favorite poets, that is Faiz Ahmed Faiz. Gulon mein rang bhare baad nau bahar chale, chale biyao ki gulshan ka karobar chale. Now see, Urdu poetry, I don't know whether you in Urdu poetry there is often an outer superficial meaning and there is an inner real meaning. Now this couplet of Faiz, Gulon mein rang bhare baad nau bahar chale, chale biyao ki gulshan ka karobar chale. Now the literal meaning, the superficial meaning is that gulon mein, among the flowers, rang bhare means colorful, baad e nau bahar means the baad means breeze, morning breeze of a new spring, nau bahar, new spring is blowing. Chale bhi aao gulshan ka karobar chale, come so that the work of the garden can be done. Now this is the superficial meaning. The real meaning is that the objective situation in the country is right, and it calls for patriots to come forward because the country needs the help now. Chale bhi aao ki gulshan ka karobar. Gulshan should not be understood to mean, the literal meaning is garden, but here it means the country. So it is a call to patriots to now step forward and help the country because the country is in great distress. Thank you. Now I invite questions from all.
So, since I was the main organizer, I'll take